Okay. I will follow up on what Paco has been telling about and PLIP. It will be related a bit to context, and especially to context Mark IV. For those who don't know what that is, it's the next generation context. I'm in the process of, and that's a bit part of the whole LuaTeX thing, just rewriting really large chunks of it. As Frank mentioned in his talk, when you let's say 10-15 years ago, you write something tech, you write it really concise and small and efficient and whatever, and it's time now to get away from that. That's what Context Mark IV is going to do. Okay, I think it's about 10 years ago that we more or less accidentally ran into MetaPost, and I think the first thing that I made was our company logo, and I said, well, it looks good, so let's go forward with using it. And by that time, I think we were still using DVI-PS1, so you had these EPS images that you could embed in your document. Then Piet Lichter came along, and I think it was Sebastian Raats who somehow challenged me into, because he also liked MetaPost, well, maybe it's possible to write something in tech that can convert the output produced MetaPost, which is actually rather simple output, and just parse it into something PDF. So I did that. And then we could use those small PostScript files directly. That the added benefit of that, because we were dealing with tech, tech could also handle the fonts that you used inside your MetaPost document. Over the time, we started extending, well, not so much extending MetaPost itself, but writing macros that can do the job, so that we could do special things like shading or transparencies. And I think, well, if you are using tech for more or less professional products, you cannot survive without support for things like spot colors and multitones and things like that. So that was also added using the special mechanism of MetaPost. And I think, also a bit about 10 years ago, we started experimenting with including the MetaPost code in the tech document. And this was possible because, well, there are basically two ways of dealing with that. You can collect the code, write it out to file, process it immediately, and then include it again in the next run. Or you could just write it to file, start MetaPost, run it on that file, take the output, and put it in your document using immediate write 18. One complication is a bit that MetaPost has this BTEF-ETEF construct, which it really loves to intercept and then call out to tech and go back again. Well, you have to go around that if you really want to do it efficiently, and that was taken care of by some kind of intermediate processing. I think if you talk about using MetaPost in your document, and you use MetaPost, for instance, for running headers, for fancy things, or nice ornamental chapter openings or whatever, then you end up with many runs, and in many cases the graphics that you result are more or less the same, and in that case it's handy if you can reuse them. So we quickly built mechanism that will be using similar MetaPost things. I think I can safely say that it was the fact that we had MetaPost that drove us into adding very extensive layering support to context. You can have multiple layers of graphics and text and whatever. And the nice thing about MetaPost graphics is that they know about these things. They can adapt themselves to these situations. Just to give an example, if you have, you say, I've got this framed piece of text and you have a nice shape behind it, it would be handy if the shape is, if the, there's more text, so the area becomes large, that the graphic can adapt itself automatically. And I think that like that, then you need to communicate between your tech run and your MetaPost run, and that kind of stuff was present. And I think that if you, I have no numbers about that, but if you who do an inventory on the contact mailing list, you will probably notice that maybe 50% of the users somehow is using MetaPost for doing things. It can be making a nice title page or adding all kinds of stuff to make a document attractive, but also maybe using it without explicitly knowing it. For instance, there are mechanisms for doing backgrounds behind text, and those mechanisms use MetaPost to generate the backgrounds and things like that, or underlining fragments of text or bars in the margin, all kinds of stuff that crosses pages and columns or whatever, and that's done by MetaPost code. If you look at the kind of documents that we have to do to make as part of our work, it's mostly educational stuff. And if you have ever seen a school book nowadays, I think in many cases they are not really beautiful, but they have all kinds of things that those design, like color and lots of backgrounds and all kinds of tiny markers and things that are graphical of nature. And often, let's say, openings of chapters are very complex with summaries, with different backgrounds as the numbers and whatever kind of stuff. And, well, the only way to do that in Tech is by using MetaPost, because Tech itself can only draw rules, and that's about it. And that means that, well, I'm not saying the worst case, but in the other case, you easily end up with 10 or more small MetaPost graphics per page. And that means that if you use the direct way of calling MetaPost, you have 10 MetaPost calls per page. And you can imagine that it takes a bit of runtime to get your document completed then. We're talking about 300-400 page documents. The alternative is that you collect the stuff and do it in intermediate run. The disadvantage of that is that you always need an extra run, yeah? Because, well, first run you're only writing the graphics. So on a 400 page document, a couple of seconds per page, and you're talking about 800 seconds, you're talking about more than 10 minutes extra for a run. And normally a document is not finished in one run, but in several runs, so you talk about half hour extra runtime, just to get...
Back to the 90s or the 80s.
Yeah, kind of, yeah. So, in many cases, the documents run more or less automatically on servers, mm-hmm. So we don't see it, but customers, well, it's no fun for the customers. Mm-hmm. There are some very special cases, like Marta made a package that can do GNUplot graphics that use MetaPost. Just the GNUplot is converted to MetaPost, and that's all happening more or less runtime. And again, you have the problem that if you have many of those graphics, you get all these calls to MetaPost that have to do the thing. And it's even worse if you would use text, yeah, then MetaPost itself, well, can be triggered to run tech again, to etc. etc. You can have a chain reaction of things. For things like flowcharts. This is a similar example. So I think that one of the reasons why we actually started thinking about something like MetaPost library is that we thought, well, if we can do that kind of stuff inside Tech, if we don't have to call Tech MetaPost each time, we can save a lot of time. At that time, we were already playing with Lua and LuaTech, and one of the first things that I've done is to rewrite the tech-based MetaPost output to PDF converter in Lua. So I had some experience with that part, which is actually faster, is more readable also. And so I already had spent some effort on that part. At that time, we also did a couple of experiments together with Fabrice Popinot with, let's say, having MetaPost running in the background and piping data into MetaPost and getting data back. And this is a nightmare if you talk about cross-platform. This typically behaves completely different on Unix and a Windows platform. And you have to operate via files. And, well, are files still open or flushed or whatever? So it's a mess. Yeah, we quickly abandon that idea. And that's the reason why we started defining the MetaLib project and started asking for funding to user groups, and I think the first one, Dante, who I think considerably funded the project, also triggered other user groups to step in. One decision was made as already earlier, is that if we would do the integration in, have a library and do the integration in LuaTeX in this case, then we would not do the complex text part with all the communication between DenTeX and MetaPost, because that could be handled at the tech end. But that was more or less a technical decision. Okay, so then you have this library, and well, it's sitting there, and the first thing that you have to do is to again write a converter that produces PDF. Now this time Taco showed an example where you saw a PostScript function that returned a block of PostScript code. That's not how we work in Context Mark 4. We operate on the objects, which is an alternative function call, which gives you access to all the objects that are generated by your MetaPost run. Now, the first thing, of course, that we did is test how fast is this. And I can say you, it is really fast. It's, if you talk about processing graphics, this graphic has some 5 pen shapes, which I think it's a random graphic, which has some 5 pen shapes, which gives it an average complexity, because there are a couple of paths per stroke, and also there has to be some calculations being done on the paths in order to get it properly handled in PDF. And I think we at that time had a throughput of 2,000 of such graphics per second on my machine, and we are talking of basically running MetaPost on the graphic and converting it. As already mentioned, this uses a specific pen, and the pen related output was really the most complex part. Spent quite some time figuring that out. I think the latest version, this is described the way of dealing with this in an article I wrote for Bagotech. And after that, Taco implemented basically a lot of this functionality in a helper function, so that you don't need to mess around too much with that kind of stuff. Now, in MetaPost, there is a new feature calling pre- and postscripts. Tech has specials, maybe you know a bit about it. MetaPost also has specials, but MetaPost specials end up at the beginning of your file. They're basically not really specials associated to let's say, a pass or so. In already the precursor to MPLib, there was an extension where you could associate information with paths. And my expectation was that you can use that to carry along, let's say, additional information, color spaces or whatever. So that was about the time that we also started playing with that kind of stuff. I think I can safely say that this mechanism is still imperfect, so Taco didn't mention it, but it's on the agenda to look into maybe things like attributes or whatever that are carried along with each object that a MetaPost graphic has, not only paths. As I mentioned, the library doesn't do text. Now, in context, we had already some time ago figured out a way to cheat with that. Just as tech, if it's dealing with graphics, doesn't really need the graphic, it only needs the dimensions, the same is true for MetaPost. So if you are in a tech run and you have to typeset 50 labels, instead of, let's say, writing them to file, let tech process it and then read in the file and convert it to a MetaPost image, which is basically what MPX stuff does. We followed a different route. I just typeset the 50 labels in tech using boxes, and I pass the information to MetaPost about the dimensions of those boxes. Then MetaPost sees a rectangle that it can nicely manipulate and do all kinds of things with it. And the only thing that I need to do in the converter from let's say the output generated by MetaPose to the PDF again is to say, oh wait a minute, this is actually not really a rectangle which has been rotated and twisted and whatever. It is related to specific text. So it means that you again get virtually zero runtime for adding labels to MetaPose graphics, and that's the mechanism that we use here. So what is in practice the consequence for the user is that it used to be that when they ran a document that they saw, well, in the log, tech running, oops, MetaPose call, MetaPose running, back to tech, etc., etc. And now they don't see anything of that because the library operates more or less automatically in the background, and the only thing they get is at the end a report of how much time was actually spent in the library. That means that in everyday documents, the MetaPose runtime has virtually become zero. I mean, if you talk about really complex document, a couple of hundred pages, well, you talk about maybe a second spent on MetaPose, which is compared to the whole processing time again, neglectable. So what does it mean for the user? We try to be compatible if we redesign the whole context, low level stuff, and again, in talk about the MetaPose related feature, nothing really changed. We only see a speed improvement. And it really helps in this case that users, they are quite willing to experiment. As soon as there's a new version of either context or Lua tech, they start downloading new stuff. Of course, they get conflicts because it's out of sync. But anyway, I think the it could be a bit of a nightmare, I think, for Taco occasionally. What was it, just before this conference? He posted a new version of MetaPose. And Saturday, I think, was the day that we wanted to prepare talks, and I saw mails coming by like, oh, this doesn't work, that doesn't work, blah, 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 and all that. Then you have to spend your Saturday on fixing those last-minute bugs. But I think, in general, you can say that the library is quite well tested and operates the way it should. A MetaPost format, I think in context you can better talk about MetaFun because we have a sort of extended format. There is still a format file, but users don't have to deal with it anymore. The if there's an update, there's automatically new format generated, end up in the cache, and we even isolate the formats from the ones that are normally shipped with Tech Live or whatever. They live in their own namespace. They are bound basically to the Tech format. We can support multiple formats. So it's possible to say I have a MetaFun format, or I have my own format, or I use MF Plane or whatever. And the idea is that in the future we will have the option to associate each graphic with basically its own format, so that if somebody implements a nice module using lots of graphics, then you can say, well, I want my own MetaPost format, or maybe my own instance of the format, and it doesn't interfere with anything else that users do. This is not really implemented yet, but it's relatively easy to do. The mechanisms are there. Next stage, and I'll tell more about it later in this conference, is that we are thinking of runtime font generation. Let's say that normally if you generate a font, you don't have to do that each time that you process your document. You can catch these things, and the library can easily generate 500 to 1000 glyphs per second, at least on my machine. And next time you can just load the converted image data and use it in your document. The logical follow-up on that is that you can convert the MetaPose to so-called hash strings, which are the thingies that make up a type 1 open type outline. And that would suddenly add to tech the option that you say, I've got a font with, let's say, missing shapes, just generate these shapes and add them to the font, extend the font at runtime with missing characters. By the way, for logic following up, that is, and that's the main reason why we do this kind of things, is that if you're typesetting languages like Arab, that you would like to have the option to just generate whole words, or maybe the connecting pieces of individual glyphs and things like that. Now what in practice, before I will show some of the documents that I can show the process, we have a sort of torture test for LuaTeX, which has currently some 240 pages. And there are 66 graphics in this document at the take point, 3-5 seconds, which is nearly nothing, because you also have to load the format and things like that. And that used to be 20 seconds or more. So we really take off a lot of runtime from document processing. The LuaTeX manual, which I'll also show, is even more, I think, impressive, because each page has one or at least one graphic, and that also saves one run that was run per page. This means that if I look at the kind of projects that we do, and these are projects where in most cases we have XML files that are automatically need to be converted to PDF output based on user selections and things like that. That where you normally had to deploy several servers to get this done, you now can use just one server and do the same with less resources. I even want to go so far as saying that if we wouldn't have this library, we would at some point have to decide just to quit using tech, because big and complex documents, you can't process them anymore if you don't have this kind of features and things available. It's just assumed that you have them. If you don't have them, well, you don't get to work. So. For the users, I think that the biggest consequence will be that currently it was still something like, okay, they see the document is calling MetaPost, it looks complex. That in practice users, because they won't notice anymore, will even more easily start using MetaPost and MetaCode graphics in their documents. Okay, so I have two documents that I can show where we use that kind of stuff. This is the LuaTeX manual. This is the Lua logo. And as you see on each page the logo, you see, well, if I run fast enough, you see the moon going around the earth. Yeah. And this is it's different per page. You cannot reuse this kind of information, so you have to generate it each time. And it used to be, well, one call per MetaPost graphic. And now you can't even measure anymore how fast this goes. And this is a graphic with, well, just a dashed line. And that's the interesting thing. This is the kind of stuff that in many cases desktop publishing programs cannot do. So we gain a bit of features over that. On the other hand, the kind of designs that I have to implement into styles never use this kind of stuff. They are always kind of boring and, well. This is our test document. There are a couple of graphics in there. And I actually wanted to go to... But this is another example. In this manual are some graphics that give us some insight in memory usage of LuaTeX. So this is the total memory consumption. Let's see. We can For instance, here you see in this graphic, where the mouse is on, you see suddenly an increase in PDF memory. That means that I think quite some graphics are added there that add lots of specials.
That PDF memory is a heap. Hmm? So at some point the heap becomes full and allocates another heap.
Yeah, but it happens a bit around these pages, so there must be some. Oh, this.
No,
this
is slowly getting fuller.
It's never freed? Hartmut, it's never freed. Okay, so if you have this kind of graphics and you have them to your documents, and again, you have to have some 30, 40 calls to MetaPost just for these graphics, then it's 10 seconds per time that you change something and run it again, and you quickly gain back all this time if it doesn't take any time anymore. But I think even if you forget about the future, Taco and I already gained a lot of time back by just having this library inside there. Okay, this is about what I wanted to tell. I can show something because it's not on a memory stick. I can show how it runs, but you should believe that it runs. Yep.
Any more questions? Who's using it?
People, maybe Arthur is one. Arthur is using it, but he doesn't see that he's using it.
It's hidden.
No, I had a question, but I asked you in private before. I'll make sure tomorrow. Mm-hmm.
This graphic with the moon going around the Earth.
Yeah.
You wrote that graphic in PostScript. I mean, MetaPost.
Yeah.
It's very difficult to do.
No, it is just a random. It is a circle with a random diameter and a random pen shape.
Well, it seems that if an artist is using like a GIMP or something like this, an artist is going to get somehow magically into the post.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to be a very useful thing, but to expect a graphic designer to be able to write something in the post is very difficult, because it seems like you're wanting the article to which
is
a very artistic person,
not
a very technical
person. Well, one of the projects that we have, the artist, because the designer, because he knew it had to be generated automatically, came up with some random font cover page made in InDesign, and it really looked like crap. Yeah, it was like, I think this one, just click a lot on the screen and something comes out. Thing.
Can you say it again?
Well, there was the designer who was working in InDesign made a design for a random cover page.
Random
cover page of a cover. A cover. The
front
page.
Yeah.
And I think he just made it by click, 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 and then joining lines, and that's it. And he never gave a specification about how to do it. And I think that's a bit the problem. If you talk about MetaPost and the things that you can take a moon like certain around, if you don't even know that it can be done, you will never come up with a specification like that. Yeah, well, maybe not in that area. If I look at, okay, maybe the let's say the average contact user is of course not representative for designers, but I think that if you look at a lot of documents that I see coming by made by contact users, they like randomness, they like these kind of things. So if people...
It's an amazing tool, but to write in MetaPost, it's very
That at least it gives the tech community then a certain edge over all those designers, isn't it? It gives us it's a bit of an edge over all the designers then that we can do.
Which is why it's this is the big problem. How
Maybe we shouldn't, because if everybody can do it. Okay.
But using another tool, like in this time, isn't any easier, because this logo, the original was created as a PostScript, a real PostScript program written by somebody, and this is really complex. You don't want to do this, and MetaPost is much easier to do such a graphics. And it all depends on what you want. If you use some tool with the mouse and you want to make a dashed circle, then you end up with the final last dash a bit shorter than the other.
So most artists, they don't use a mouse, they use a paintbrush or something like this. They're not people who create.
Yeah. But then you end up with something, you start with a dashed circle and the lines are not equally dashed, at least at the end.
But that if you...
Anyway, you need some knowledge to make this one right.
If you have to create 5,000 documents, yeah, you're not going to use the paintbrush 5,000 times.
I understand, but in
the
design of the book, when you sell something of very professional,
but that's a bit, I think the problem in general of designers. There are two kinds of designers. There are the ones who are willing to design something and leave the implementation to somebody else. And there are designers who design every detail and then start harassing the implementer with all these details. In practice, after, let's say, a few months, most of the customers and say, well, go ahead and fix it in the way you want because it's inconsistent or whatever. But I would like to designers more to concentrate on design and not on... And if they come up with a challenge, like say, I want to have this and this and this on each page, just do it. That's easier. If they start tweaking around themselves, it even gets worse in the sense of then you get something non-implementable.
Okay, I think we'll hold that point. Thank you very much for being here.